So the basic idea here is that typically in the marketing side, we use this concept called nudge economics, where you assume that the customers are busy, lazy, and often confused, and they are likely to take whatever option you give them as a default option. Okay.
Okay.
What that means is, so let's say you go to maybe Flipkart or Amazon, right? One good example is, they don't show everything to you. They have, like you must have seen in the other case study, they have millions of products available, but they can't show all the TV. I mean, there is only so much screen space available in your mobile phone. What they do behind the scenes, they sort of do an intelligent and educated guess on what is a product that is most relevant to you. And they will make sure that products are always coming at the top. For example, based on my purchase history, since I often keep buying diapers for my child, whenever I go to Amazon, there are always some diaper offers that are popping up in the top, right? Like, it must be something else for you. So I think the main point here is that it is not like I can't purchase other things from Amazon, right? If I want, maybe I can even buy a shirt from Amazon. You know, all those options are there out for me when I search for them. But by default, what I'm going to be shown is what Amazon thinks is the most relevant item for me. And in most cases, it also makes my own life easier also, right? Instead of going and typing, I want, this diaper of this size and all every time, the moment I go there, I see, hey, this is the option I want actually. So I just click, go to the payment option, pay, and it's done for me, right? So this is the concept called nudge economics, where people believe that instead of giving consumers too many different options, you sort of gently nudge them towards that option that you believe is the best for them. 70%, 80% of the cases, maybe it is actually the best option, so they are directly going to click on, their life is easier, happier, and done. Maybe 20%, it is not actually the best option, in which case they can still go and do whatever other things that they want to do.
So this is somewhat counterintuitive, no, Venkat? Sorry, Milind. Because normally, one would say that for a consumer, you should give him a lot of options, and then the consumers evaluate these options, and then they make decisions and so on. Now you're saying the opposite, actually. You're saying consumers actually don't like to be given so many options. They like to be told, you buy this, this is good for you.
I think this is probably, I don't know, I'm not an expert on this, I think, but this is the difference between the traditional economics and behavioral economics.
Okay.
You sort of assume everyone to be a rational agent who is evaluating all the options available to him and like a utility function and sort of maximizing utility. In behavioral,
maximizes, so there's a cognitive problem, which means that people can't process information, so much of information. They'd like to reduce the amount of processing, I guess, right? That's basically what
I've seen. I've seen in my own life, when I go to a restaurant, fancy restaurant with a huge elaborate menu card, I keep browsing, I'm not able to decide what dish I want to eat. When I go to McDonald's, there are only 3 or 4 options of burgers available, which they show in bright big things. And I always think that one first one that I typically go with.
Milind, you wanted to ask something, sorry.
No. So, and I was just reflecting when Venkat was talking about his example of diapers, and you know, I buy a lot of books from Amazon, and so Amazon is always showing me books. So even if I log into Amazon to buy something else, because they show me a book, I'll end up buying a book as an impulse. So I guess they're also trying to encourage more of these impulse purchases, right? Even if you have come to the site to buy something else, by showing you something that you are very likely to buy, you also land up buying diapers in your case, Venkat, I'm assuming. Even if you actually went in to buy a shirt, you probably land up buying a shirt and diapers.
That's true, sir. Yeah, correct. I mean, without that nudge, probably I'll forget that I had to buy a diaper. Maybe in the last minute, I'll go to the downward shop and buy it manually, right? So now they are avoiding me doing that, and by showing it to me, they're making sure that I always end up buying from them.
Yeah, in retail stores, there's this business of nudging where they keep desirable things somewhere near the checkout counter. So, chocolates, exactly. Yeah. So, when you're standing there for checkout, you'll kind of automatically be nudged to reach out and get it. And I suppose even in e-commerce, they started to do that. When you're checking out, they'll say a few more things before you check out. Maybe you want to look at these things, something like that, they say.
Definitely. Retail example is a good one, right? Traditionally, we see chocolates and candies put near the checkout counter.
Yeah.
Interestingly, read one another different example yesterday where apparently a supermarket in US wanted to promote healthy food, like, you know, fresh fruits and vegetables. So what they did, they along the, you know, walking path, they put the green arrows that lead towards the fresh fruits and vegetables. So they discovered that people who are normally unlikely to buy, suddenly somehow they unconsciously follow those green arrows.
Oh, I see.
So there's an enormous amount of psychology, consumer psychology that is being used to shape buying behavior.
Definitely, sir. I think it is a lot of psychology because traditionally people don't think about, right? I mean, the way like Professor said, the earlier mode of thinking was, these are all the options available from my company. I'm going to throw all of that at you. You as a consumer, you decide what is best for you, which is putting a lot of choice on the consumer. Today, it's the other way around where we are saying that I will think through what is relevant for you and only present that option.
Fantastic.
Just to tie the loop on why it is important for us. Now, think about, again, the company like PayBuddy, right? Now, you as a consumer already has multiple different, you know, credit card, debit card, bank account and all in your PayBuddy wallet. Now, whenever, let's say you are on the verge of making a purchase, you know, of a mobile phone using PayBuddy, the moment you hit your final checkout screen, PayBuddy typically shows you all these options. It'll say, hey, you have an SBI credit card, you have an HDFC credit card, you have a Axis Bank bank account. And by the way, I am also offering you this pay later option. So essentially, they in a normal world, they end up presenting 6 or 7 options for you. And a lot of people get confused. At that point in time, they are like, oh, what do I choose now? Should I use my existing credit card? Okay, if I use this credit card, I get 1 month to pay it back. Oh, maybe I should choose pay later option from PayBuddy. So this creates a bit of confusion in people's mind. And that's where this, again, nudge economics concept we want to use. Because we want to show the customers whatever is most relevant for that particular customer for that particular transaction, so that he doesn't get confused between the multiple funding options available for him.
I wanted to ask you about that AI driven, because AI is something that I think everybody reacts to nowadays. AI driven propensity model. What is propensity model and what is this AI driven?
Sure, sir. So again, taking the same, so we discussed about this nudge economics concept, right? Where we said, we want to show whatever is best and relevant for you. Like Amazon shows diapers for me, for Milan sir, it shows books. Now, how are these decisions happening? It is not like they have people there thinking about what is relevant for Venkat and what is relevant for Milan sir, right? So somewhere, they've collected a lot of data about you and they put this data through AI algorithms. These algorithms can assimilate large amounts of data about your past behavior and decide whatever is the right next best thing for you. Propensity in this case is sort of like, you know, your inclination or likelihood. So essentially these AI driven propensity models are going to say what Professor GV is likely to purchase next, what Venkat is going to purchase next, and what Professor Milind is going to purchase next. So for each one, it is a personalized recommendation coming from that AI-driven propensity model, depending on his or her lifestyle and needs and whatnot.
And these models must be fairly complex, Venkat, because I remember Omkar was telling us they have something like 10 million SKUs in their warehouse.
1 million.
They have 1 million SKUs in their warehouse. And out of that, they are able to pick up those 3 things that I'm most likely to buy and sell them to me.
Correct.
Yeah. If you think about it, right? In our examples, we took like, you know, what you normally do, and they are showing you that. Like you said, you buy books, so they show books. I buy diapers, they show diapers. But they don't do only this. They also want me to try new things, right? How do they do that? When they say things, there are, like Professor said, there are a million options available. They can't show something randomly to me. Then what they do, these models also look at people similar to me in their database. The model will look at, okay, this customer is similar to Venkat. And he last month ended up buying a new iPhone 11. So I think that is also going to be interested in iPhone 11 because Venkat shares many characteristics similar to that person. Venkat is of a similar age group. He seems to have similar spending habits on a monthly basis. So therefore, a lot of this goes in the background to pick out the most relevant, you know, and good option for you from all that million options available.
Mm. Yeah, and sometimes I've seen they tell you actually saying, you know, people also bought XYZ.
Mm.
But sometimes they don't tell you.
This is called, in a more formal, the word precisely is a recommendation engine. It's a very famous e-commerce world. Netflix is another good example. Netflix is almost supposed to be the pioneer of this recommendation engine concept. Essentially, Netflix again has the same problem that there are these millions of movies and TV shows available in Netflix. So when I log into Netflix, now does Netflix show something random? No, it doesn't. It again uses all these recommendation engines and AI-driven models in the background to decide the most relevant thing for Venkat. And apparently, it is fairly the main. They say that the main reason for Netflix's success is the AI models behind this, what it shows to the customer.
So in our case, there are all these, you know, 7, 8, 10 payment choices, and our challenge is to figure out which payment option to recommend to the customer. Is it
as the default?
Right? As the default.
Yes, sir. So in a way, yes, the problem is slightly, you know, of lesser complexity than you would say probably for a Flipkart or a Netflix, because we are not talking about million options. We are talking about 6 or 7 funding options available to you. But still, unless the choice is made in the right way, the main risk you run is, let's say you show an irrelevant option to the consumer, right?
Hmm.
The problem is that the consumer might not like it. And he won't ask you for another option. He'll just close off the window and start doing something else. So this is called as transaction drop in the online world. It's a big risk. Like there's a study that says that many consumers who start doing a transaction, like they add things to their cart and then they finally go to the payment page. At this point, the dropout rate is almost 30 to 40%. So if 100 people...
30 to 40% of the people... take their card to payment and decide to drop. Is it
correct?
Oh my goodness!
Because you know the whole online world has made very impulsive actions very easy for you.
Suddenly
right?
Get a change of heart. So actually, if you make that process hard, then the guy suddenly has a change of heart. You know, oh, exactly. Why am I paying this? Why am I doing this? Huh?
Exactly. In fact, that is a big pain point for many online retailers, because people come to them, they put all the items in the cart, they go to the payment place, and then they drop off things. Right?
I see.
And that is why it's really important to make it simpler so that they have a higher chance of completing the transaction.
And interestingly, in real life, people don't seem to do that, right? You know, I've seen once or twice people do it. You know, you put 10 items in your basket and maybe at checkout you put one back. But you typically don't abandon the entire basket.
Correct, yeah. Sir. It's less common because, I don't know, if you think about it, you're taking the pain to actually drive to the supermarket. And then there are other people who look absurd if you walked up to the checkout counter and then suddenly drop the basket and ran away. But probably in the online world, the effort is very simple. Like whenever you are bored, like even I've seen my wife has this habit of checking what's new on Flipkart and Amazon, right? So whenever you in the phone, maybe impulsively you add a couple of items to your basket, and then sometimes you take it to the checkout page. So yeah, I think online makes it a lot more easier to do these kind of, you know, impulsive actions.
Right. Okay. So, yeah.